Good morning and welcome to this interaction session. I will go over to each one who is logged in and request the following. Number one, whether or not you have been able to identify any students from your college who are doing the CS101.1X on IIT Bombay X, and if so, how many are there? That is question one. Question two is, if you have such students, then please tell us about at least one important and useful question that was raised in your interaction so far with the students, either raised by the students or raised as an example by you. So these are the two inputs that I seek from all participants who are logged in here today. I have the OHM institution.
Hello, good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Sir, some of our students want to communicate to you. They have some questions regarding computer programming.
Good morning, sir. So my question is, what is a null pointer and when it is used?
A null pointer is not a very useful commodity. It should be avoided by all means. A null pointer results when you have assigned some pointer to a memory block, but if the value inside that pointer is zero, then it means it is not pointing to anything. In general, this will not happen if you have created that pointer variable properly and if you have assigned that pointer variable a value which is the address of a memory location. However, if you have not assigned a value, or if the memory location whose value you are trying to assign does not exist or has not been allocated space, then you will end up with a null pointer. I hope that answers your question.
Is it better to use a pointer or to navigate an array of values?
If you have an array of values, then the best navigation is done through the array index. That is the fastest, and that permits you to do a random access at any point in time. In general, the address computation using an array index is quite effective and is quite natural whenever you are dealing with an array. You will use pointers typically only when you have allocated memory for either that array or for anything else independently. Please note that any manipulation of index effectively refers to pointer calculation internally anyway. For example, the first element of the array, let's say array A, so A0 when you mention, actually you are referring to the pointer to that 0th element. If you later on do any address computations, the address computations result in calculation of an appropriate pointer to the element that you are trying to access. So, in principle, there is no difference between using pointers and using array indexes, but at the external face within your program, whether you use pointers explicitly or whether you use array index determines whether your access or navigation is through pointer or through index, but both are internally equivalent in C++.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Is C language independent platform or not?
There is some confusion about the word independent platform. I do not understand what you mean by an independent platform.
Just like Java is an independent language. Is C language is independent platform or not?
Okay. Programming languages, particularly higher level programming languages, are defined independently, but in order that a program written in any programming language will run properly, you require a whole lot of other tools and other components on top of which the translated code will sit. For example, if you take C or Java, or for that matter COBOL or Fortran, all these languages will compile all the compilers for these languages will compile the programs and translate them into an executable code. But that executable code itself has to run on top of something. Typically, it is the operating system, the runtime environment, and the runtime libraries of the respective compilers which will be required. So, to that extent, no programming language can be considered to be a totally independent language. When you talk about an independent platform, it means that whatever code you have written can run independent of absolutely anything else. There is nothing else that is required to run that program. As we know, it is not true. Let me further add that what you mean actually is not the such complete independence of a language platform, but what you mean is whether a language can work independent of other programming languages. To that extent, every higher level programming language is an independent platform anyway. C programming language precedes Java by decades. Java came into picture only to facilitate object-oriented programming. It represents a different paradigm of programming. An object-oriented paradigm was introduced in C through C++. When Stroustrup invented C++, he was essentially introducing object-oriented features in C. The languages, programming languages, should be compared on the basis of what are the features that these programming languages offer. An independence of a programming language is generally not talked about because it does not make much sense. To conclude, any programming language that is available is in a way independent because it is independently defined. It has its own independent compiler, and that compiler, when it works on the programs that you write, will generate an executable code. To that extent, C is independent, C++ is independent, Java is independent, Fortran is independent, etc. However, as I mentioned, the code that is generated by the compilers has always to be executed on top of something. That something is either the operating system or the runtime environment of that programming language, including library. All of these are the underlying platform on top of which your code runs. If you really want to talk about platform independence, then the only independent code that comes to my mind is an embedded system in a device. For example, an embedded program inside a washing machine or a refrigerator or a television or the navigation control of an aircraft. Such embedded systems are complete in themselves. The programs could have been written in C, C++, Java or whatever. But when the programs are compiled, the compiled form along with the minimum necessary code of the operating system, all of it is taken together and is embedded into the hardware system. That is truly an independent platform because nothing else is required to run that code. I hope this explanation is adequate, slightly longish.
How can I remove the trailing and leading space from a string?
How can you remove that leading and trailing space from a string? First of all, how do you get the leading and trailing space inside your string, which is represented, let's say, as an array of characters? You have to start from there. If you are using cin or any conventional mechanism, then you will never get any leading or trailing space in the string. You will get only the leading non-trailing space character string in your array. However, if you have read, for example, an entire line of characters, then inside that line of characters, you will get all the spaces in between as well. And that is where you might have leading space or a trailing space. The only way to get rid of these is to examine every character and examine successive spaces that you encounter, which could be either a leading space, a set of spaces, or trailing set of spaces. In either case, you will have to remove them by examining them and by transferring non-space characters to other strings. Next week, there will be specific exercises and examples on how to handle strings, including the spaces in between, spaces leading, spaces trailing, etc., etc. there are some interesting examples on how to identify commas and comma separated values. So when you look at the next week's material, many of these questions will be clarified to you. I would suggest that you wait for 1 week and look at those examples.
Sir, I have one question. Sir, we know the difference between structure and union in C programming language. We know the difference only in terms of storage management. Is there any other difference between structure and union?
Very good question. Again, this question is answered completely in the material for one of the weeks that will come towards the end. But it's an important point that you raise. I would like to retain the curiosity of all your students. Primarily, what you say is true. The fundamental difference is in the way in which the storage is managed. The objective, obviously, of both these constructs is to permit the common accessing of a group of elements together. You do it in one way in structure, you do it in another way in union, where you might have multiply different structures, all of them share the same space. But I would elaborate on this through additional material in the last week of this course. Thank you very much for these questions. We are going to the Royal College of Engineering and Technology. Yes, over to you.
Sir, I am Kavita from Royal College of Engineering and Technology. First of all, I would like to thank you, sir, for such a wonderful session. And I have two questions in my hand. The first question is, the difference between call by value and call by reference. Call by value we know, but in a call by reference we are passing the address. That is again an unsigned integer. So is that call by value itself? That is the first question.
Let me first answer the first question. Call by value and call by reference. I think instead of going into the details of how exactly that mechanism works, it is important for all our students to understand that fundamentally, in one case, the entire value is transferred and the value is directly available in the called program. In calling by reference, we are not passing the value, we are only passing the address. In which format the address is passed is actually immaterial for higher level programming. But the fact is, you cannot have access directly to the value in the called program, but you have to access it by a reference. Makes a lot of difference in the way you write programs. Primarily, it has to do with the amount of work that the runtime compiler has to do. For example, if you were to pass, let us say, an array of 100 elements by value, then you will have to transfer all 100 values. You will have to allocate space for 100 elements in the called program, and the whole operation will become very costly. In call by reference, when you pass only a reference, you are not allocating any fresh memory in the called program, and you are using the memory which has been pre-allocated in the original program calling program itself. So that is the fundamental difference.
Second question. Suppose we have defined a string S is equal to ABC. And we can access S of 0 to be A, the first character. And it is also possible to access I of S to be A. Then what is the reason behind it, sir?
The internal calculations for the going to that particular element is same, whether you call it S of something or I of something. And that is because, as I mentioned, in case of an array, internally, all computations result in a pointer to be calculated and pointing properly. So when you say S of 0, you are actually referring internally, not externally in your program, but internally to the pointer which is pointing to S of 0. When you say S of 1, actually internally there is a pointer which points to the next element of S. So that is plus 4 bytes or plus 2 bytes or plus 8 bytes, depending upon whatever is the associated memory space. I would suggest that the pointer way of usage is not very appropriate for an initial course. For the first course in programming, it is best to refer to an index of an array as the appropriate way of referring to that particular element value. Because the C language was originally based on heavy pointer calculation and it was often used for writing even compilers, for example, system software and so on, many programmers preferred to use the pointer way as being more effective and efficient for themselves. But in a computer programming course, where we wish to emphasize the usage of programming to solve other application problems, such as computational problems or text processing problems, etc., in my own opinion, it is preferable to restrict ourselves to use of indexes of the arrays. So, if S is an array, for example, string array, the best utilization according to me will be S of 0, S of 1, S of 2, S of I, that is ith element, nth element, etc. But to answer your question, either usage is equivalent internally, there is no difference. Kuntal Patel has raised a question. I am starting interaction with Kuntal Patel here.
Sir, program is going on very well and students are also submitting various quizzes. Some of the students were asking for mid-semester examination and semester end examination related to this course.
Okay.
And that is first question. So, and second one is related to is there any kind of projects which they are supposed to submit at the end of this course? So they were asking these two questions to me.
But both the questions that you raise are important questions. So let me answer them. At least this recording will be available for all others to view later. So it is useful to raise such questions. So the first question related to mid-sem and end-semester examination. This course does not have any mid-semester examination. It will have only end examination the week after the entire course ends, which would have been an 8-week course. But now, as you know, we have added a recapitulation week. Therefore, the course will now be 9 weeks long. But there will be only one end-semester examination at the end of the course. There is no mid-semester examination. However, you will notice that we have a series of quizzes and we are going to take the best 5 out of the total number of quizzes that we conduct. And also there is a series of online program submission for which the first programming assignment, has it been given already? It will be given now. So this is a novel concept where people can write programs for a programming problem at home, compile it, test it, etc. But they have to submit it online. And we have an online automatic grader which will automatically compile these programs, run them with some test cases that we have created and will immediately allocate a score to the students. Normally, you know, we ask only multiple choice type quiz questions, but in a programming course, we must ascertain that people are able to write programs. Now, these programming exercises, they don't have to write full programs. We have given, I believe, some sample programs, how they will have to submit and so on. We believe that this is an exercise which will permit them to test their longer program that they write. There are totally 5 program submissions that they will have to make in this course, out of which I think 4 will be considered for evaluation. Four out of six. So that is the equivalent of our long programming answer question. But that's all will be there as far as the honors grade certificate for the students is concerned. However, an important point that you raised is about project. Now, I agree with you, Kuntal, that is the case with you, perhaps with us and with practically every good institution where the programming that is taught in a particular subject is buttressed by either assigning an individual project or a group project to the students. Now, unfortunately, in an online mechanism, we still do not have a foolproof way of either guiding the project or evaluating the project. And that is one of the reasons why we depend heavily on teacher colleagues like you who are mentoring those students in the local colleges. I would strongly suggest that, and this is, I am addressing it to all other teacher colleagues who are attending this workshop, that let us take this Kuntal's observation as a mandate for us And let us, in our own colleges, whosoever are the students whom we find who are doing this online course and whom we are mentoring, there may be 5 students, 10 students, 20 students, but I would suggest that each one of us teachers should actually think of some projects like this, allocate these projects and guide the individual or group of students to do these projects. Today, we do not have a mechanism to capture these marks that are locally allocated and make them part of the grading. But tomorrow, starting from June, as Professor Vitthal Kamath had suggested, we will be actually doing a blended mode course where the university or the college will be actually willing to take the marks obtained in the MOOCs course towards their recognized grade or recognized marks in their university itself. This mechanism will turn out to be very useful. So, thank you, Kuntal. I will add very specific details about the project and suggest how the teachers participating in this workshop can think of these projects, allocate these projects perhaps at the end of 5 weeks of this course so that the fundamentals are done. And maybe I will advance the discussion on software engineering principles ahead so that the students will understand how larger projects are planned and executed. Very good suggestion, thank Kuntal. You. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Let us go over to Sona Kumar. There is a hand raised here.
Good morning, sir. I am Sona Kumar from JSS Academy of Technical Education. So my question is, what is the pointer of const pointers?
Sorry, your voice broke in between. I can understand pointer to a constant, but what do you mean by pointer to a constant pointer? I did not get it. What I will do, Sona Kumari, is that I will give a reference to a web page. Basically, this conversation has happened many times in Stack Overflow. And when we discuss the pointers, we will be mentioning explicitly which are the allowed pointers and non-allowed pointers. So, I will request you to hold your question till the discussion on pointers takes place in the course, in the regular course. There is another related question raised by Gulshan Goyal. What are the limitations of pointers? I do not understand limitations in what sense. Pointers are merely a mechanism of accessing memory. So, to that extent that I can access memory, there are really no limitations. But I will once again repeat that while pointers are important both to this course and to actual programming, in a first course of programming, pointers should be treated merely as an introduction to an interesting mechanism. But their use should not be encouraged unless it is absolutely essential. The student should be taught on how to access memory by using the names that we give to those memory locations. The very purpose of variable names or array names is to access those memory locations. The purpose of pointers is the same thing. The usage of pointer becomes very meaningful when you go to the internal mechanisms of handling these memory references. But in any case, please hold on till the material on pointers is exhibited in the course. You will get your answer to these questions as well. Yeah, on the Stack Overflow, if you are interested, I will ask my colleagues to put up a reference to the discussion on Stack Overflow. But that discussion describes very well what is the permitted set of pointers and what are not permitted set of pointers, etc. We will have that web page reference added to the Moodle. The next one is Sujit Deshpande.
We are taking time to adjust to the MOOC environment and the course is going on properly. We are doing the assignments. Only the thing is, as we were having the midterm examinations, some quiz are missed out by the students. The graded quiz.
Yes. As I said at the very beginning, you were saying something more, but let me first answer your question. Yes, it is possible that some students will miss out on one of the graded quizzes. and that is because the timetable and the time pressures that different students will have in different colleges and different parts of the country will not be identical. We do not have a uniform timetable. Secondly, you will notice that we did not start this course at the beginning of a semester, but we had to wait for the launch and we started it halfway through. So let me answer this question both in terms of short term and long term. The short term answer is, tell the students not to worry about it, because we have first of all delayed one graded quiz because of the recapitulation week. We said we will have it later. Secondly, the best score in some quizzes out of a total number that is conducted will only be taken into account. So suppose I miss one quiz, or even if I miss two quizzes, it does not matter, okay, unless of course I do very badly in other quizzes. But in which case, even if I had attended one of these missed quizzes, I might have done equally badly. So that's a chance that we have to take. Of course, if somebody attempts all the quizzes, even then only the best score in the five will be taken. So they need not be unnecessarily worried about missing a quiz. That is not an issue. Same thing about the submission of longer programs that they will have to do online. We will always take the best so many out of the total number of submissions. This is the short term answer. The long term answer is, in the month of June, July, when we will be again running this course, maybe in a slightly modified form such that it matches the syllabus of the most colleges in the country, that is from the next academic year. In that case, many autonomous colleges and some universities, you would recall the observation made by Professor Vitthal Kamath last time from Gujarat Technical University, where Gujarat Technical University is actively considering factoring the marks of these MOOCs program into their respective grades for the students. So when we run such a program, it will be a full-fledged 13 or 14 week program, and it will try to align itself with general timetable that is followed by the students in their semester. We will also realign some of the topics etc. appropriately. In such cases, what would happen is, in most of the colleges where students are participating in MOOCs, there will be regular teachers assigned to them who would normally be teaching courses there. They will be their mentors. In fact, that is one of the objectives of running this workshop. Then they will do not only the supervision and problem solving for the students, but they will also give local assignments. You will recall, as just now Kuntal Patel mentioned, that there should be programming projects. I am sure that in your own college, when you teach programming, you would be giving some programming projects to the students at the end. If you don't, it is a good idea to give. That is what we will be stipulating. Now, when we do that, such programming projects will be entirely supervised by the local teachers only. They will guide them and they will evaluate them. And we will make provisions such that the marks which are so allocated by local teachers are factored into the total MOOCs marks, so that the final grade that is given is a combination of online assessment plus the local assessment. And thereby, hopefully, the grades would be accepted by the university. In the next semester, we may even suggest that the weekly quizzes which the students give, currently we give them 24 hours or 48 hours time to give the quizzes. But if the quiz marks are to be accepted by the university, at least some of these quizzes will have to be supervised. So we'll be requesting the respective teachers to conduct such quizzes in their college online on a Saturday or Sunday. We'll all jointly agree with a timetable such that the quizzes get, not only they are good, they are even good today, but they get the sanctity of acceptance by the respective college and university. So this is the long term plan. In the short term plan, I will repeat my answer. Tell your students not to worry at all. Even if they miss out one or two quizzes, the total number of quizzes which will be considered for the marks of the final grade will only be so many out of the total. So I hope that answers your question.
Okay.
Good.
Sir, Yes, sir. Thank you so much. One of our students wants to ask a question,
yeah,
so I'll pass
please,
it to
please.
Him.
Yeah, please.
The student representative of the entire team.
Good, good.
Hello, sir. Why the float the integer like data types are having the different types at different platforms?
Okay. So it is not just the float, even the int may have the same thing. The problem is that the C or C++ language families does not stipulate a fixed size for all data types. Many sizes are left to be implementation dependent. What C, C++ says is that the minimum size or the minimum value that is represented by an int or a float must be this. The maximum value represented must be this. But if a particular implementation uses more bytes, for example, that is permitted. And that is the reason why you may not have exactly the same size on different platforms. So all the compilers that are available, they should follow some standardized mechanism. Now, if you use GCC, for example, the GCC will follow a standard mechanism independent of where it is implemented, whether it is implemented on a PC or a server or whatever. Now, in such cases, you may have a uniformity of allocation of space for a particular data type. But if you use different compilers, even there, wherever C, C++ exactly stipulates that the size of this should be so much only, it will be followed. But wherever the C, C++ language itself says that this size is implementation dependent, then that is left to an individual implementation, and you and I have no control over such a thing. I hope that answers your question.
Can I ask one more question?
Yeah, please, please, go ahead.
Sir, is it possible to write the main function inside a main function? And if yes, then what may be the base condition or termination condition for that function, main function?
So actually, recursion is an extremely interesting phenomena, and what you say is entirely possible. You can call the main function inside the main function itself. However, I have a very curious question. Why would you do that? Under what circumstances or for solving what problem will you be required to call main function within main function?
Sir, I solved a quiz in which they are asked about it.
Okay. You see, I personally dislike such quizzes which ask you about such esoteric usage. It is like saying that I normally eat like this, but what happens, can I eat like this? The answer is, of course, I can eat like this, I can eat like this, etc., etc. But a programming student and a programming teacher should say, it is preferable to eat like this. So therefore, while such questions are interesting because they explain the possibilities in a programming language, we should also, as students and teachers, learn to concentrate on what are considered good, simple and decent practices. Because the objective of writing a program is not only to solve a problem by yourself, but the program that I write might be used by 20 other people later. That is the objective of writing programs. Now, not only such programs must work correctly, they must be most easily understood by everybody. And they should be most easily expanded by everybody. So that is the objective of writing software. And if we want to be true to that objective, while it is useful to understand such esoteric features of a programming language, but what needs to be emphasized is clean programming practices, simple programming practices. In that context, the recursion is a useful feature, but recursion extended to main function itself, at least I cannot think of a problem which cannot be solved other way without using main function from within main function. So I hope that clarifies the both the answer and the stand. Right. But I would like to meet someone who said that quiz,
yes,
whether you can call main function from within main function itself. interesting, Nagesh. We have not asked this kind of question. Maybe I'll ask this question to my IIT students next semester. Shefali Agrawal. Yes, Shefali, over to you.
Hello. Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Yeah, sir, I just want to know about the report format. Actually, in our previous interaction, you were talking about the report format in which we have to submit some report regarding mentor-mentoring session.
Yes.
So, it is not uploaded in the Moodle or anything else?
No, it is uploaded. The format in which you have to submit a file, what I had suggested is you can use any spreadsheet either in OpenOffice or Microsoft Office or any other tool, but you have to create a comma separated value format file, a CSV file. In fact, I spent considerable time with my colleague to define it. Please check your Moodle again. On the Moodle, there is a submission link and also a link which gives explicit instructions on how to create such a file. We want, for example, as a mentor teacher, the teacher email ID, the unique name which is there for the teacher on the IIT Bombay X platform, then the student's email ID, student's unique name in the CS101.1 course and some such information. Please go through the Moodle once again, it has been explained. Although the date has ended, you can still submit that file even now. We will make sure that such a submission is accepted, no problem. I am going to Nagarjuna.
Very interesting program, sir, MOOCs program.
Yeah.
And lot of learnings are there. And here, sir, we are also working with spoken tutorials, wherein we are also conducting spoken tutorials on C language for the students. And the students are getting immensely benefited out of it, wherein they undergo the course. In the conventional way of teaching, the faculty takes the classes on C language, which is university curriculum. Apart from that, after some reasonable portion is completed, we introduce the spoken tutorials to the students on C language. So they also, the students are learning, around 20 videos are there, which covers almost maximum portion of the C language there. And the students also appear on the online examination. So this is one way where the students are getting more exposure towards the programming languages. And here also we are learning many things in MOOCs, the way the students are going to learn. And really we feel very happy that you are taking much interest in terms of C language, and particularly the concepts, the depth of the concepts and the insights that you are giving into. It's of immense value to the students. And we are very much eagerly looking forward to take this course forward for the students, sir.
Thank you very much. Is there any special query or question that is raised by your students in your interaction with them?
It so happens, sir, as of now, since the students are undergoing the spoken tutorials and four batches.
Right.
And somehow we have not made the students to register long time back also. By that time, you also mentioned that it is not mandatory for the students to join.
That
I really
right.
still feel, but even if an opportunity, I feel that I have missed the opportunity of making enrollment of the students. Since the last date were over, I could not able to make
no,
any
no,
attempt in
no,
that
no
direction.
No problem at all. But what I wanted to know is whether, forget these students who are doing online course, but these other students who are doing these spoken tutorials, if there is any interesting programming problem that is raised by these students to you or someone else, it would be useful to entire community of online people, including teachers. So please keep in mind that if any query related to programming is raised by even those students in their own spoken tutorial way also, it could be useful to reflect that query onto our own discussion forums here. Thank you so much.
Sure. Thank you.
There is a query from Neha Gupta. Let me go over to Neha Gupta. Yes, Neha, over to you.
Sir, I have already uploaded my students list on Moodle, and we are weekly having sessions with the students to clear their doubts. What else we need to do as a mentor in this workshop?
you are required to raise one or two important questions which the students raise, or one or two important examples which you give in such interaction. You will be required to upload that information onto Moodle. I will be preparing a separate link for such submissions with instructions there. The idea is that whatever experience you have in discussion with your students, at least the important part of that discussion is shared amongst the larger community. So we don't have too many teachers, we have about 250 teachers who are participating. But imagine if such 250 samples of experiences are shared on the Moodle, all of us will be enriched by that experience. So therefore, what I suggest is, I am very happy that you have started interaction with the students, but please jot down any important point or any important query that is raised by the students, or any important example that you give to the students to explain something. Now, in every interaction, you will have two or three such points that are discussed, but just in your opinion, what you think is a very important or a critical point which could be of use to many others. That experience you should jot down. It could be an example, it could be a query raised by the student followed by your explanation. So prepare that write up and keep it ready. I'll be putting a link which is meant for all the participating teachers like you, and you will have to upload such experience on that link. Now those experiences will be shared by all the teachers. Additionally, I will also be selecting some specific queries which the student participants are putting up on the discussion forum. Now those queries are being answered by our TAs, but some interesting queries I will put, and I will request our participating teachers to suggest how they would like to answer such a query. So that is an important learning in handling online discussion forum. So these things will now follow. Right. Thank you so much. So I am going over to Deepak V. Bhosle.
Can you use the turtle for the advanced programming, such as for the pointer or any other applications?
The question is, can I use the turtle for introducing advanced programming concepts such as pointers, etc.? I will mention that the objective of introducing the turtle was merely to make initial programming exercises a bit more entertaining and a bit more interesting to the students. The turtle was never meant to be a very important programming concept for later usage. So its introductory part has been done, and we will leave it at that. We will introduce other concepts later through other appropriate examples. Neelam Chaplot.
Hello sir, I am Neelam Chaplot from Computer Science Department, Jaipur Engineering College and Research Center. I have started late on the course, so I was not able to enroll students over here. But as I came to know today that in June, July, you are again going to start with something, some MOOCs on this particular subject. So I would be really interested in enrolling my students for this particular thing. And it is a really nice experience to be in this interactive environment and to learn so many things from the MOOCs. And I would really like to proceed further with this working on MOOCs and things like that. Thank you, sir.
Thank you for your comments. I will conclude this session because there are no more people connected today. Please note that this entire recording will be released onto the Moodle. So all other remaining teachers will be requested to look at this interaction and continue with the additional discussions that will happen on the workshop forum. Thank you so much. Over and out.